How you been since we last spoke? It's been, what is it, a few months ago? Half a year? What the heck is it? Do you know?
Yeah, I think it was May 11th when I did my last interview. So yeah, it's been quite a while, and I've been keeping busy, traveling down to South America quite a bit, actually, studying ayahuasca shamanism specifically, but other forms as well, and pretty much also traveling around the United States down to southern Arizona and South Dakota for the Lakota tribe. And yeah, pretty much just doing a lot of field research and getting ready for this next film, in which we're going to have a lot of new research and a lot of really good information in this next film that kind of piggybacks off of Esoteric Agenda, but more or less the end of Esoteric Agenda that had more of the solution topics.
Excellent. And your travels, are those mainly, because of the film, or have you done some other, things down there?
Well, down to South America was more specifically just for the film. I've actually met up with a lot of people from around the world that, after seeing the film Esoteric Agenda, they became interested in bringing me down to meet several different shamans. One was a Colombian shaman named Berne, pretty young actually for a shaman, around 37, 39 years old, something along those lines, but amazing in his work, and also the music that he plays, called the Acaras. And originally, actually, my first trip down there to Peru, Iquitos in Peru, was with I think it was the Shipibo tribe, and Don Robert was the shaman down there. Absolutely amazing, amazing heritage and culture down there. It's incredible. But in the States, actually, when about a week ago was when I went out to the Lakota tribe. The shaman out there named Basil married my fiance and I, so that was just about a week ago.
Oh yeah, very recently. Again, congratulations on that. And I guess was quite a nice ceremony, a quiet little, a smaller one, or was it a lot of people there?
No, it was really small. We went out there. It was my first time actually meeting with that shaman. I talked. The person who actually introduced me was a person named Rob Cabito of the Karuk tribe out in Mount Shasta, a very good friend of mine. And yeah, he introduced me with them. So it was just kind of on a whim. We knew we wanted to get married, but we weren't sure how. We didn't want to really get married in the eyes of the United States with a marriage license and all. So this was the perfect opportunity, and it was a. I would say maybe like a 36-hour ceremony, because for the first 24 hours was actually a fasting period where we were my fiance and I were alone in a ceremonial house with no food, no water, and no speaking for 24 hours, confined to a little area on a buffalo robe with tobacco offerings with different color flags. In the Lakota tribe, they have different colors that signify the four cardinal points. So we were pretty much in this little, maybe 5 by 8 area for 24 hours with no food, no water, no talking, which was pretty difficult for me because I'm one who loves to talk.
And how about the fasting? Have you done that before?
Oh yeah, actually, down in pretty much a lot of shamanism, peyote shamanism, San Pedro, ayahuasca, a lot of that type of shamanism, you have to fast at least for a half a day, at least for like a 12-hour period before ingesting the plant, just because it's for one, with ayahuasca especially, you purge, so you don't want anything, you don't want too much in your stomach to get out, and plus it also just it allows for better metabolizing in the system. So I've been doing fasting for most of my life with a lot of my meditation, things along those lines. So fasting was not a problem with me.
How do you
Actually,
feel?
not having water was actually the biggest problem I had.
Oh, that, yeah, that, I don't know if I could handle it without water, actually, but
Yeah.
without food wouldn't be any problem for 24 hours. What do you feel, what's your sense of it when you actually do stop eating food for a little while? In many cases, those times that I've done it, it's a very kind of, it's a spiritual experience in itself, actually, because your mood changes so incredibly, and you become much more calmer and settled down once you get over the kind of the initial pain almost as it can be, you know, when you don't eat. But that only happens like the first, you know, let's say the first between 6 and 12 hours. That's when you can have a little bit of pain almost in your stomach.
Yeah.
But that kind of passes fairly quickly, you know. How do you, what's your sense of it?
Well, yeah, it definitely passes. And the body is a tricky thing. It's really quite interesting how when you don't eat for a while, especially, I mean, not to get graphic about this, but we know how much we carry around inside of our intestines, like how many pounds of, like, you know, digested food we're carrying around in our intestines at any given time.
Yeah.
It can get up to 20 pounds. And when you actually fast for 24 hours, you're giving your GI tract a little break, which is great because I'm not sure of the exact number. I think it's somewhere around 50 to 60% of all of your energy during the day goes towards digestion. So when you fast, it actually frees up a lot of that energy. It allows for your GI tract to clear some of that out, but also all of that energy then is used for you and not just digestion. So it actually, in a way, gives you more energy, which would kind of be the opposite of what you would imagine.
Hmm. Yeah, and I think that it's very important that you mentioned the fact that you can let it rest for a while, the system, not constantly being subjected to, you know, breaking down the food or what have you, So mm-hmm. I think it's an important thing. So on top of that, then you have first the fasting in itself, which is an interesting experience, but then mm-hmm. above, on top of that, you have the ayahuasca experience. I guess it's you get two, what do you call it? You hit two flies with one rock right there, you know? So you get a double whammy, as it were.
Absolutely. Well, with ayahuasca especially, it really does act as a laxative in many ways. Like that's one of the most comical things is when you're down in South America at any point and you can't control yourself in that way. So it can get kind of unnerving, especially to Westerners. But once you kind of get used to used to that environment, it I've done it so much I'm completely used to that. But the actual, like, ceremony with ayahuasca is it's just kind of brutal altogether, in a sense, because you're not only do you have, like, that whole problem going on, but just the nausea that hits you at certain times when you're purging. And then on top of that, that's all besides the actual shamanic experience, like exactly what you're down there for. All of that is just beside that experience. And even the food that you are allowed to eat when you're down there on the days in between the ceremonies, usually it's really good food, but there's many types of foods that you shouldn't be eating. You shouldn't be A, drinking alcohol, B, no pork or red meat. You have to kind of limit your sodium intake, your refined sugars. So it's kind of, you know, the whole experience is really, really healthy for you, because everything that's involved with that experience pretty much helps you clean out your GI tract and just pretty much just clean out your organs and your skin and all the toxins from your system. So it's pretty interesting.
I wonder if some of the Western people that aren't too, you know, up to speed with their own, food, so to speak, if there could have a worse experience, because again, it's all the processed food, the garbage food that we eat. And if you get down there and do something like this, then the body at the same time cleanses itself, meaning that you're not going to have, again, I know that the drug is not for leisure, so to speak. This is not just for entertainment. So it's another thing here, but it could actually be doubling up for some of the people that aren't, keeping a good tabs on their own food intake, so to speak, you know?
Right, absolutely. And it's all of that along with culture shock, because I'm aware that people do, even in the United States and other than South America, do practice ayahuasca shamanism, and that's more of what you would call neo-shamanism, and I don't find any problem with that. But ayahuasca is indigenous to the Amazon, so going down there, that's really the true form, at least in the environment and the setting of it. So if you want that experience, it's also culture shock if you've never been down there, because when I went into Iquitos, Peru, we were right in the thick of the jungle. I mean, to where it's you can't even really walk through. There's so much dense vegetation, you can't even really walk through the woods. And the only way we would get around is right on the Amazon River. We would take canoes and boats to visit some of the other tribes. So
Yeah.
it's definitely some heavy culture shock there if you're not used to that.
Definitely. And how is the I talked with Freeman a while back, and I think he got a bad case of food poisoning when he was down there as well. So you have that on top of it. I don't know if the sanitation is that particular good. I don't know. That might be only to some of the more denser populated areas. I don't know.
Definitely when you go into a new area of the world, the water is going to be a little bit different to you. So you get a lot of people that have a problem with just the water causing things like diarrhea and upset stomach and things along those lines. But when we first got into Iquitos, just the actual city of Iquitos, I went into one bar before hopping onto the boat to actually go into the jungle. I went into one bar to use the restroom, and just to give you an idea of how sanitary these places are, it was pretty much a garage with the garage door open. There was a picnic table with bottles of liquor on there. They used no more than three or four cups that they would just continuously wash. So, I mean, only four people would be drinking at a time, and usually it was just you'd be drinking a shot. And the bathroom was just in the corner of the room. In one of the corners, they put up a little tapestry, kind of like a blanket to cover that part of the room. And when you go in there, it's literally just a 5 gallon bucket. So that's their bathroom, no sink, nothing.
Right.
So I mean, that's just to give you an idea of how sanitary. And that's just Iquitos. That's not, all over Peru.
Sure.
There are much nicer spots. I've been down to Cusco and Lima, but just in Iquitos, right where I was, the town that we had to go into for food, that's kind of that'll give you an idea of how it was there.
And where is Iquitos in Peru approximately?
It's northern. I guess it's northern central Peru.
Right.
Maybe a little bit more to the east part, but it's right in the thick of the Amazon.
Okay,
So,
gotcha.
and actually, a lot of that footage is going to be in the next film, Kymatica, because a lot of, got footage of a lot of the tribes of the actual ayahuasca kitchen where they prepared the ayahuasca, and also the floating cities of Iquitos, which is absolutely beautiful. I mean, anyone who could get a chance to at least, view some pictures of it is well worth it, because there's entire cities just floating there on the water, and people's houses, even far, like, they farm somewhat, obviously not large amounts, but they farm on the water. They have chickens and dogs that, as the backyard, they go out and play in the water. The kids, from their house, there's like an open wall or something like that, just because usually all the houses are just one room, and the kids, instead of having a backyard to play in, they just jump out into the water. And then there's bars, there's clubs, and it's actually kind of funny, because instead of in a city where you see a lot of kids driving around in their souped up cars, there's kids here trying to pick up, like there was a group of three like teenage boys trying to pick up on these girls floating next to him in their canoe. So it's just kind of interesting in that sense.
Oh my God! Yeah, I'm looking at some pictures of this right here, and I had no idea that a place like this existed. Wow,
Yeah,
that's
oh,
really
it's
interesting.
definitely interesting.
So this is this any has is this a flooded area? Does this only happen like once every year? Is this all the time?
No, it's right on the Amazon, so that's how they live.
Right.
And I mean, obviously the water level rises, so they don't anchor the homes to the ground or anything like that, because then that would cause the water to enter the houses. So they're literally just, they're tied to other houses and ultimately tied to the shore, so they don't float down the river,
Right.
but they're not anchored to the bottom. So when the water level rises, the house would rise with it, and then also lower with it as well.
So, I mean, again, if we return to the kind of sanitation thing, is it like a cesspool, that the water is it used as a, dumpster as well,
I would have to imagine. I'm not gonna say for sure, just because I don't know if they I really I'm not sure if they go off into the woods to go to the bathroom or to bathe or anything along those lines. I think they bathe in the actual Amazon,
Right.
but I'm not really sure about what they do with kind of like, the bathroom setting. I'm not sure if they just go straight into the water or go
Sure.
off in the woods. I'm not, I
Sheesh.
don't, I'm not really sure about that.
Yeah. Well, okay. It's I mean, I guess one as always has to be a bit careful when being down there. I
Yeah,
guess
yeah.
you know if you
Oh,
come
believe
from
me,
a
I kept my hands out of the water for that part,
yeah, I
so.
can imagine. Okay, so very interesting. So you have some footage down there. I'm glad you mentioned that because I wanted to ask you about that as well. You know, in regards to I guess you might have even started to edit some of the material yet. But I mean, did you have a lot of hours of footage from down there?
Quite a bit, yeah. I would say, and the biggest problem I had was the fact that my HD camera was broken or getting fixed at the time, at least, and so I had to take down more of a consumer grade camera. So the quality I'm working with it, I mean, you'll get the idea in the film. I mean, the film is also going to have kind of an independent vibe to it.
Sure.
It's not going to be too polished and pristine, just to give it, a texture and a sense that's a little bit more palatable for people that are into the more independent movement. But yeah, so the footage, I mean, it's decent. I'm going to be working with it as much as possible with color correction and all that. But I would say maybe I got about two, maybe an hour and a half worth of like the floating cities and just miscellaneous things here and there. I didn't get any in Peru of the actual ceremony, but I got the ayahuasca kitchen. I got some footage of the shaman preparing the ayahuasca, and also we traveled because there's a lot of indigenous tribes right around the same area that we visited, and they would take us in, they would feed us, and then they would kind of just show us the some of their dances, some of their songs, and kind of just their lifestyle, and then we would move on. So I got a lot of that. That footage that I'm going to be including in the movie.
Nice. And was it a hassle carrying around all the equipment? I mean, did you have separate audio stuff, or did you pick up that from the camera? And you know, did you have if you had a lot of stuff with you, was it a hassle or you know, troublesome carrying all that stuff around?
Well, actually, it was just the camera. I again, like I didn't have the with this camera, I had the microphone that I used for my HD camera. It didn't have the attachment for this. It didn't have a mic input or anything along those lines. And I was going to bring some form of external audio equipment, but I wasn't able to. I wouldn't have been able to carry that around because, like you were saying, yeah, it is. It was a hassle just getting through the woods because
Yeah.
there weren't like clear, walking paths for much of this. There were some, but a lot of it, even if I didn't have a camera in my hands, even if my hands were free, it still would have been pretty difficult. Like we were climbing over logs, basically in trying to balance ourselves to walk over logs that was our only way of getting across certain streams and rivers and things along those lines.
Well, it sounds like a really interesting adventure, that's for sure. And
Yeah, definitely.
then you spend some time again there. We can go back and talk about the Lakota a little bit, maybe. They, as far as I understand here, they actually declared their independence from the U.S. back in, let's see here, I think this was back in 2007, around December. I know that a few news stories came out about this, talking about the fact that they've declared independence from the U.S. And did that affect anything of your decision to do it there?
Well, it actually didn't. It didn't really affect my decision. It just made it a lot better of a decision because I was interested in visiting the Lakota tribe just because I know a lot of their oral, traditions and a lot of their the history behind it. I've read up a lot on Native American legends and myths. So I was very interested in meeting them regardless. That was just kind of the icing on the cake when I got the opportunity to go out there and get married by the shaman. So it's definitely very interesting that they declared sovereignty. And when I was actually lecturing up in Toronto, maybe a month after I did my last interview with you, and I was lecturing up there, and there was a person named Robert Paget who he is pretty much just he's a professional researcher on maritime admiralty law and things of that nature. And I guess it's the Blackfoot up towards where he lives in Alberta, Edmonton, Alberta. And they, I believe, did the same thing. I'm not too sure about that, but I know that the kind of what he was getting into is when he was speaking with those tribes, he found out the actual history of the British colonization and the fact that apparently, now I haven't done my own research on this, but apparently it's a partnership between the original indigenous peoples of the Canadian area, which they called Turtle Island, and it's like a 50-50 ownership between between the Crown and the indigenous people. So they call that that whole spot of land Turtle Island, all of Canada, and it actually reaches down into the South Dakota, because when I went out there for the marriage ceremony, Basil, the shaman, he spoke about even his land as being a part of Turtle Island. So I thought that was really interesting.
Right. And just to remind, I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but we had Kevin Annette on the radio show here recently and talking basically about how the Native Americans in Canada specifically actually are being eradicated and has been for the last, you know, well, ever since the Europeans basically got over there, but that this actually is continuing until this day, and that there's, you know, they're being terrorized, they've been putting into these, you know, school systems and what have you. So, I mean, it's a heck of an awful situation over there, I know, and if it feels like, at least when talking to Kevin, that, you know, every Native American tribe is being subjected to this in one form or another, that they're being either suppressed or even, you know, eradicated in some form. Did he talk about that, anything at all?
No, he didn't. I didn't get a chance to actually even listen to that interview. I was definitely very interested in it, but I ended up listening to the Paul Levy interview, which actually he touched upon a lot of the things I wanted to touch upon today, so I had to kind of change around some of what we're going to talk about. But I definitely am aware of what's happening up there to a small extent, and it's like you said, it's been happening for quite some time now.
Yeah.
It's nothing new. Obviously, there's even in here in America, the Native American tribes, even the Lakota, a lot of the stories and everything that I was just receiving from Basil, the shaman, of their history, how they actually broke off into the Nakota, the Dakota and Lakota tribe, as kind of like a branch of what they would call the Sioux. But I guess they don't consider themselves a Sioux tribe. They consider themselves either a branch of the Nakota or the Dakota tribe.
Right.
But yeah, just, I mean, it's incredible the amount of genocide that's not spoken about. There's a book actually called the People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn that it's a large book, but it gets so into the Native American tribes and just the colonization and through Columbus and those colonizers up here in North America, and then Pizarro and who is it, Cortez.
Yes.
You know, all throughout the Americas, just the Portuguese and the Spaniards. Yeah, the colonized. I mean, it's been happening, and it's definitely nothing new. The most amazing aspect of it, though, is how little it's really even brought out to the public. I mean, like all the genocides that have been happening, you know, in Darfur, in obviously in World War II, and pretty much all over the world that you hear about consistently, even to this day, you hear about how those are some of the most brutal genocides.
Right.
Yet nothing is really spoken about. Indigenous tribes like Aboriginals and Native Americans.
Exactly, and it seems to be kind of they are handpicking what kind of genocides we are to hear about, because again, we never hear about the Armenians, and as you say, many of these South Americans and Native American tribes are never talked about. The Aborigines in Australia,
right,
all over the place in a way. And we, you know, as you said, we usually hear about the Holocaust, you know, about the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
We hear about, you know, some of the other stuff going on. But no, so it's really interesting, and it's worth highlighting that again, because, you know, it's happening in all the time. And I think that, you know, Kevin Annette again talked about the idea that this goes back to very much of the agreements of the Commonwealth that the, you know, the British royal families were setting up at that point, and basically taking over the land for many different reasons, but primarily in order to gain the resources there. And I think that even the things that took place in Kosovo and Bosnia is a part of that same agenda, so to speak, of actually getting into an area and occupying it in one form or another and getting control of the minerals, the wealth that are in the particular region at that time. Africa, again, Nigeria, the oil and the diamonds down there, you know, goes on and on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And I think, I mean, the way that I look at this, I mean, I typically can't get around it. I usually look at everything as in a symbolic way. And when I look at this, it really just has more to do with, you know, what else would you imagine? Especially, you know, I refer everything to biology and in a medical approach. What would you imagine invades a certain area, depletes it of its resources, and then moves on?
It's a cancer.
That or a parasite.
A parasite, you know? Sure, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, and that's the way that I look at a lot of this, and I believe that it's a psychological parasite, you know, it's a spiritual parasite. It's not something that is, it's not something that's really just in physical form.
Sure.
It's something that's happening on a collective level, and actually what I was mentioning about, was it Paul Levy that was talking about, he mentioned something about what a parasite, the nature of what a parasite does is it will invade the host, start depleting it of his resources, but then will also emits like little chemicals out into the bloodstream that encourages or kind of like makes the host crave certain foods that will put the nutrients that doesn't serve the host, but it serves the parasite.
Right.
And
yep.
And then it basically that's exactly what it is, and that's the way that I look at, that was a perfect way to put it, because that's the way that I look at all of this colonization, you know, specifically from, you know, the Commonwealth and specifically from the Crown that goes into areas. And these are the areas that you hear the least about.
Yeah.
You know, these are the genocides that you hear the least about when, I mean, you look in Africa with the diamond mines and everything, how arms and, you know, the munitions and everything is fed to one warring tribe until, basically they'll pay them off with arms and munitions to protect themselves. And in return, that tribe will harvest all the diamonds and pretty much as soon as they get close to eradicating the other tribe, they'll pull out all those munitions and give it to the neighboring tribe that they were at war with. And it's just this... pretty much this cycle that goes on and on and on without completely eradicating either tribe. They just dwindle them down to nothing,
well,
you know, and in return, that's how they harvest the diamonds.
Absolutely, and at the same time, keeping these factions fighting with each other, because again, I remember posting a story about this just a while back, about the actual son of a former French president and an Israeli-Russian billionaire. These are only two guys among 40 that are actually charged with trafficking arms to Africa. So these are the people who are putting in money into this, all of this stuff. Because again, you end up wondering, you know, each almost like every new half a year or every few single months, you hear about some new dictator, you know, rising to the top in some, you know, already, you know, very setback country, so to speak, of Africa, and that already is in a very bad state. But someone new comes along. And here they come with their, you know, bombs and their guns. And who, you know, who's financing these people? You know, it's
exactly.
It doesn't just happen out of its own. You know, they don't just, you know.
It doesn't pop up out of nowhere.
There you go.
It's
yeah.
Always, and it's
right.
Always an unseen hand.
Yeah.
It's always an unseen hand, and usually, especially when you're talking about finances, it shifts and it changes hands so many times that it's the paper trail really loses itself. So it's kind of difficult to see. Where it's truly coming from, but it doesn't take a lot of ingenuity to figure it out. Usually it's
no,
you
exactly.
You look at, you know, I mean, obviously it was the same thing with 9/11, and it was the same thing with a lot of these false flag terrorist attacks. Just look at who benefits the most, who benefited the most from, you know, the Patriot Act, the Homeland Security Act. It's the, you know, those are the ones that you really have to look at first, because isn't that what we do in, you know, when when authorities are when detectives are investigating a crime of some sort, you look at who would have had motive.
Yeah.
So that's really just the most logical way to even look at it. So, but it's just an unfortunate thing that usually without hardcore evidence, it doesn't really make a difference to people who really just don't want to. Actually, I have, see if I can find it. I have this quote by Nikki Rapana, who actually talks about, she does a lot of articles about the communitarian law.
That's funny that you mentioned that, because we're just right now in contact with Nikki, and we're going to have her on pretty soon here on the show, actually.
She's an excellent researcher. I've talked with her recently, actually when I was starting to film the movie Chymatica, because I want to use a lot of her. She made an excellent article called CAFTA, the EU and Communitarian Law. And what's interesting is communitarian law is it has a lot of parallels too, but it is not the same as maritime admiralty law. So I found that interesting because I've been doing a lot of research on maritime admiralty law, and that's interesting enough. But anyway, my favorite quote that she even put in that article was, part of the problem is the American people don't believe there are any more Hitlers or Stalins.
There you go.
And I thought that was perfect, because that's – and it's not that they just don't believe it, but they don't want to believe it.
Right.
They don't want to believe – I mean, like, deep down aside, obviously they feel that they're being governed. You know, spiritually, psychically, soulfully, they know they're being governed, but
and in many cases, they want to be governed as well.
Well, absolutely. Actually, another thing I wanted to mention was both Wilhelm Reich and Arno Gruen speak about, especially Wilhelm Reich. He talks a lot about sexual suppression and The Invasion of Sex. Compulsory sex morality. And he talks about what is called the incapacity for freedom, and I'm going to try and find this this quote that he gave. It was just absolutely excellent, but he talks about it's an incapacity for freedom that we have because of our sexual suppression and perversity, because that's a natural biological function that we're then repressing. And here's the quote. When he's talking about sexual suppression supports the power of the church, which right there, that says it all, but
yeah.
Sexual suppression supports the power of the church, which has sunk very deep roots into the exploited masses by means of sexual anxiety and guilt. Now that's compulsory sex morality right there.
Yeah.
And he goes on to say, it engenders timidity towards authority and binds children to their parents, which I go on to say, I mean, saying it engenders timidity towards authority and binds children to their parents, in my words, not only does it bind these children to their parents, but since we're not really teaching our children anymore, you know, how to live differently than we did, since we're not putting them in, or since we are putting them in the exact same scenario that we were put into, which gave us our psychological schism.
Yeah.
These children, they leave home as adults, and all they do is they simply they don't have independence at that point because they never learned it. So they simply replace their parents with government, with 9-to-5 bosses, with cultural standards, and he even states that so eloquently in his work. He goes on to say, sexual suppression paralyzes the intellectual critical powers of the oppressed masses because it consumes the greater part of biological energy.
Well, that's
perfect right there. I mean, that's a perfect statement right there, because it's absolutely true that it. He even says it paralyzes the resolute development of creative forces. So right there, it paralyzes the intellectual rationale and the creative forces, because it consumes such a large part of our biological energy.
Well, exactly. And also the idea then of first on one hand suppressing it from the moral church in a way, you know, but then at the same time you have this kind of perversity and very, you know, promiscuity in the media, you know, with this sex idolization on another level. It's still very much suppressed though. But it's still, you know, out there. So it kind of serves the purpose of manipulation, because it creates this allure, if you will, of something that just as Reich emphasized that is what takes up our, you know, energy or even focus on that regard. Mm-hmm. So you're drawn to it at the same time as you're not allowed to be drawn to it, because it's, you know, the church tells us that it's immoral or what have you. So we're being, just as you say, it's a very huge schism within the human psyche, and I think that the play on that as a kind of mind control theme, if you will, you know, if you know about breaking up the mind into fragments and traumatization and etc., you know, huge story there, absolutely.
Well, yeah, and I mean, you pretty much hit the nail on the head right there about how it's played upon in the media. And I come from the school of thought where I understand that there are agents, that really do employ this kind of sexual suppression and perversion in a way. But I believe really what our society and our media really has to do with is it's an extension. It's our extended mind at play. When you're looking at the perversion of our, internal workings of our shadow, you're seeing that on a large scale when you're watching the TV. When you look, out into your society and your local community, that is literally an extension of your extended mind, of your shadow, playing out in real time. And that's it, like you said, in the media, when you see all the perversion of sexuality, it's kind of it gets to a ridiculous degree. Because if you think about it, now I'm not for or against any of this, but just look at what is, especially in this society, what is all right for our children to be involved with. There's this game, Grand Theft Auto. And it's kind of an interesting game because I mean I've never played it myself, but I've watched people play it, and it's interesting because the object of the game, and maybe I'm not completely right about this, but the object of the game is literally to steal cars, to steal purses from old women, to run over those women with the old cars, to basically act as a pimp, to shoot people, the most horrific violence that you can imagine that you see in like action flicks. And these are games that 5, 6-year-old children are playing, yet make sure that that child never sees anything even along the lines of a passionate, movie or something that shows maybe not even softcore porn, but maybe a little bit of nudity or anything that has to do with sex, like that's taboo. But violence, war, crime, defamation, that's fine.
Well,
Just make sure that.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I have to slink this in here that actually the outcry that did happen over Grand Theft Auto was at a actually a hidden kind of Easter egg thing where we actually could have sex with someone in the game. And that
Are
was
you
what,
serious?
yeah, sure. And that was what people were
Oh,
so
yeah.
upset about because, oh my God, there's sex in the game, but then you can go bash in the head of an old, old lady and steal her purse or whatever. And that's fine, no problem.
Right. So they're fine with that part of it.
Right. Sheesh.
But it's just this overwhelming idea that sex is taboo. Sex is something that is dirty, So it's, I mean, if you think about it, sex is just as important to the survival of the human race as eating, as breathing, as drinking water. It's just as important. Yet it's what Wright calls compulsory sex morality. It's, I mean, think if you were able to apply morals to eating, if you were to something that's so natural and biological, if you were to apply morals to it, what do they call that? That's bulimia. That's anorexia. When you're bringing your conscious mind into it, and you're basically depriving yourself of something natural, or just perverting the idea of it, which is basically what happened in sex. It's a perverted natural biological function. So it's something that nowadays, parents are afraid to talk to their children about something along those lines. And in Reich's work, there's a tribe called the Trobriander in the early 1900s that he was studying, or someone else was studying, but he studied the research of that person, of the Trobriander tribe. In They're a matriarchal tribe that had really no problems whatsoever with violence or psychological schisms. There's no suicide rate, nothing along those lines. And they allow their children to experiment with sex at pretty much whenever age the children are ready to. And I'm not, again, I'm not for or against any of that, but I'm just showing like some of the research that was done. This is what is it? Also, the Eskimo tribe up in Alaska before the in you know introduce before TVs and media was introduced up there, they were holding on to a long, like, thousands of years of heritage and culture and history. And then within 15, 20, 30 years of introducing televisions and TV programming and the media to these tribes, within 15, 20 years, the females, there was a suicide rate that began to emerge. There was eating disorders. They were wearing different more Western types of clothing. They had gotten rid of all of their sled dogs and replaced them all with snowmobiles, things along those lines. So they it completely eradicated their culture there just through the perversion of these things. So it's really, Reich definitely, you know, hit the nail on the head when he talks about what it really is it's an incapacity for freedom. It's not the fact that we want to be free, and because, you know, you can intellectually say, yes, I definitely want to be free, but then, you know, try it for a moment. Try not depending on the healthcare system or government handouts or pretty much anything that is set up for us to use that we weren't able to get by with without it. It's an incapacity for freedom that he's talking about.
Yeah, absolutely. And the idea there that you mentioned before about that they want to control us on the most primal levels. If we think of eating, having a house to stay in, you know, shelter, you have warmth, you need certain types of things in order to sustain yourself as a human being, and then on top of that you have sex that we have been talking about. But just think back then of what areas that they primarily have been interested in controlling. If we think about food, for instance, on the last show we talked about Codex Alimentarius, the food code, and that's all about controlling the food supply. There are local farms still left, of course, but they're being eradicated every day. Basically, we have huge industry farms taking over everything, and basically what ends up happening is that we have to go to a store every day and buy the food, you know, from over the counter.
Right.
So that's
right.
Huge control right there. And then we have the energy control, of course, also one of the biggest, money schemes going on right now, either be it energy in form of oil or, you know, gasoline, what have you. also the fact that you just plug into the wall and everything is supplied for you. You know, we have the electricity, the hydro, whatever.
Right.
So obviously the next level of control above that is to control sex, you know, and in that sense, I think that they've really done a good job, as it were, to get into the minds of people, you know, getting into the mindset of people and try to get into their morality in order to say to them or convince them of what is right, what is wrong, and what is being dirty. So I think what we're seeing here is basically we're being cornered on all the most primal drives of all, and that, I feel, has been basically the plan since day one in order to maintain their control over us. That's how I see it at this point.
Oh, absolutely. That's exactly correct. I mean, it's the easiest way. I mean, think about it. If you're talking about some type of hierarchy here, just look at how parents get their children to let's say eat their vegetables or clean their room. Usually it's either a form of bribery or it's a form of trickery. It's a form of, explaining that, you know, vegetables, you know, make you grow stronger so you can beat up that bully at school that's picking on you, or, hey, I'll give you, you know, like, I'll let you play video games for 10 extra minutes tonight if you eat your vegetables or clean your room. So it's not, you know,
it's a bargaining going on.
It is, and that's exactly what it is. It's what it's doing. It's rooting yourself into the psyche of somebody to allow them to do your bidding for you, and that's exactly what we're seeing on a hierarchical scale within society. Whether it's by design or by accident, it's coming from the top down, and we archetypally allow these people, you know, these maniacs that we have in power today, we allow them to rise to the surface. And yeah, we love to think that, you know, especially, you know, here in America, you know, we're independent, we're free, we're strong and everything along those lines. But, you know, don't take away my unemployment, don't take away my my welfare, don't take away, you know, any government handouts that I might have. And so it's pretty much we love being governed. And it doesn't come from actual government. It doesn't come from actual authorities on the street or politicians in the White House that are actually governing us. It's the fact that deep down inside, we'll settle for any type of governance because we've lost our capacity for freedom. We've lost the comfort, you know, of knowing what our own freedom is. And that's the biggest problem that I see. And I touched upon this a little bit in my last interview with you, but language is so flaky nowadays. Words are used. What we know is doublespeak. Even people to themselves don't even know what they mean by freedom. people themselves don't even know what they mean by love and by compassion and things along those lines. So when you hear a word, all they do is they usually take the best dictionary definition that they've heard along those the lines of their life, and they stick with that. They don't really look into, well, what is freedom? Am I truly free, or am I just a blissful and happy slave right now?
Right.
Because
right.
That's usually what it is. And usually we are not slaves to anything but our own psyche. We're not slaves to anything but this psychological schism that we've been talking about.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And I think, again, it's the idea of government is something that arose from our, we demanded it to begin with in one sense or another. And to begin with, fine, it might have been a very good idea. Work together is nothing wrong. But again, it's so easy. It so easily gets out of hand, as it were. But Ben, I want to do this right now. I want to take a short break. Do you have time? Do you want to continue talking with us in the member section?
Absolutely.
Great. Superb. Before we finish off here, then, tell us a little bit about the new upcoming film briefly. Tell us about your website so people know where they should go to get some updates on the developments of the film.
Okay. Well, the website to go to is talismanicidols.org. Okay, that's TALISMANIC idols, IDOLS.org. And it's just one page right now. Being just a one-man operation here, it really, and not being a web designer or anything, I'm basically trying to develop it a little bit more, but it's just one page right now. It just has a little clip from Esoterica Agenda and a little bit of a tidbit on what Chymatica is going to be about on that site. And it also has a little bit of information and my email address to get a hold of me if you would like a copy of Esoterica Agenda. But yeah, Chymatica, it's with any luck, it's going to be coming out in late January, early February. There's a lot of new developments that are coming every day for that film, as you and I were talking about earlier. I'm going to be having Bruce Lipton become a part. Bruce Lipton's going to be on the show or in the movie. He's going to have a part in it. We're going to try and involve you in any way possible, and possibly one more researcher. But it's really just going to get, if you want to understand like more of what the film is about, it has more to do with the degradation of language, okay, logos,
yeah.
Also, and how that plays into maritime admiralty law. It gets very much so into what we were just talking about with Wilhelm Reich's work of the incapacity for freedom. It'll get a lot into shamanism and divination and kind of how that plays into new quantum field of science, and just touches upon a lot of those subjects. It'll get into DNA, and it's going to be jam-packed full of information, probably like an hour and a half to 2 hour film. And if anyone would like any more information, feel free to email me at any point. I'd be glad to answer any questions. Married in the eyes of the United States with a marriage license and all, so this was the perfect opportunity. And it was I would say maybe like a 36-hour ceremony, because for the first 24 hours was actually a fasting period where we were, my fiance and I were alone in a ceremonial house with no food, no water, and no speaking for 24 hours, confined to a little area on a buffalo robe with tobacco offerings with different color flags in the Lakota tribe that have different colors that signify the four cardinal points. So we were pretty much in this little, maybe 5 by 8 area for 24 hours with no food, no water, no talking, which was pretty difficult for me because I'm one who loves to talk.
And how about the fasting? Have you done that before?
Oh, yeah. Actually, down in pretty much a lot of shamanism, peyote shamanism, San Pedro, ayahuasca, a lot of that type of shamanism, you have to fast at least for a half a day, at least for like a 12-hour period before ingesting the plant, just because it's, for one, with ayahuasca especially, you purge, so you don't want anything, you don't want too much in your stomach to get out, and plus it also just, it allows for better metabolizing in the system. So pretty young, actually, for a shaman, around 37, 39 years old, something along those lines, but amazing in his work, and also the music that he plays, called the Acaros, and the originally, actually, my first trip down there to Peru, Iquitos in Peru, was with I think it was the Shipibo tribe, and Don Robert was the shaman down there. Absolutely amazing, amazing heritage and culture down there. It's incredible. But in the States, actually, when about a week ago was when I went out to the Lakota tribe. The shaman out there named Basil married my fiance and I. So that was just about a week ago.
Oh yeah, very recently. Again, congratulations on that. And I guess was quite a nice ceremony, a quiet little, a smaller one, or was it a lot of people there?
No, it was really small. We went out there. It was my first time actually meeting with that shaman. I talked. The person who actually introduced me was a person named Rob Cabito of the Karuk tribe out in Mount Shasta, a very good friend of mine. And yeah, he introduced me with them. So it was just kind of on a whim. We knew we wanted to get married, but we weren't sure how. We didn't want to really get married. I've been doing fasting for most of my life with a lot of my meditation, things along those lines. So fasting was not a problem with me.
How do you
Actually,
feel?
not having water was actually the biggest problem I had.
Oh, that, yeah, that, I don't know if I could handle it without water, actually, but
Yeah.
without food wouldn't be any problem for 24 hours. What do you feel, you know, what's your sense of it when you actually do stop eating food for a little while? In many cases, those times that I've done it, it's a very kind of, it's a spiritual experience in itself, actually, because you become, your mood changes so incredibly, and you become much more calmer and settle down once you get over the kind of the initial, you know, pain almost as it can be, you know, when you don't eat. But that only happens like the first, you know, let's say the first between 6 and 12 hours. That's when you can have a little bit of pain almost in your stomach. But
Yeah.
that kind of passes fairly quickly, you know. How do you, what's your sense of it?
Well, yeah, it definitely passes, and the body's a tricky thing. It's really quite interesting how when you don't eat for a while, especially, not to get graphic about this, but we know how much we carry around inside of our intestines, like how many pounds of digested food we're carrying around in our intestines at any given
Sure.
time.
Yeah.
It can get up to 20 pounds. And when you actually fast for 24 hours, you're giving your GI tract a little break, which is great because I'm not sure of the exact number. I think it's somewhere around 50 to 60% of all of your energy during the day goes towards digestion. So when you fast, it actually frees up a lot of that energy. It allows for your GI tract to clear some of that out, but also all of that energy then is used for you and not just digestion. So it actually, in a way, gives you more energy, which would kind of be the opposite of what you would imagine.
Yeah, and I think that it's very important that you mentioned the fact that we, you know, you can let it rest for a while, the system, not constantly being subjected to, you know, breaking down the food or what have you, or, you know. So I think it's an important thing. So on top of that, then you have first the fasting in itself, which is an interesting experience, but then above, on top of that, you have the ayahuasca experience. I guess it's you know, you get two, what do you call it? You hit two flies with one rock right there, you know, so you get
Yeah.
a double
Oh,
whammy, as it
well,
were.
absolutely. The
Yeah.
with ayahuasca especially, it really does act as a laxative in many ways. Like that's one of the most comical things is when you're down in South America at any point and you can't control yourself in that way. So it can get kind of
How you been since we last spoke? It's been, what is it, a few months ago, half a year, or what the heck is it? Do you know?
Yeah, I think it was May 11th when I did my last interview. So yeah, it's been quite a while, and I've been keeping busy traveling down to South America quite a bit, actually studying ayahuasca shamanism specifically, but other forms as well, and pretty much also traveling around the United States down to southern Arizona and South Dakota for the Lakota tribe. And yeah, pretty much just doing a lot of field research and getting ready for this next film, in which we're gonna have a lot of new research and a lot of really good information in this next film that kind of piggybacks off of Esoteric Agenda, but more or less the end of Esoteric Agenda that had more of the solution topics.
Excellent. And your travels, are those mainly, because of the film, or have you done some other, things down there?
Well, down to South America was more specifically just for the film. I've actually met up with a lot of people from around the world that, after seeing the film Esoteric Agenda, they became interested in bringing me down to meet several different shamans. One was a Colombian shaman named Berne,